know how sometimes in the course of the morning sermon, I ask you a question or two or three or five, and I'm looking for answers. Today is one of those kind of days. Got a lot of questions I'm going to ask you, so I need you to stay with me, pay attention, don't be falling asleep on me. Or I might play a trick on you like the old preacher. He had a farmer that always came in late every Sunday, and Scott Squilly had to sit in the front row. And just as soon as the preacher started speaking, the farmer drifted off to sleep. And the preacher put up with that for week after week after week, and finally he decided he was going to teach the farmer a trick, a lesson that he would never forget. So in the middle of the sermon, as soon as the farmer dropped off to sleep, he whispered into the microphone, "How many people would like to go to heaven and stand up?" And everybody in the congregation stood up except the farmer. He said, "Thank you. Sit down, please." He said, "How many people would like to go to hell? Stand up." Stood up. And he looked all around and he said, "Well, preacher, I don't know what we're voting on, but it looks like you and I are the only ones in favor." Just keep that in mind if you start drifting off. I may get you. I'm going to ask you a bunch of questions this morning. We're going to start with the picture that is up on the screen, or you can look at it on your bulletin cover. I would like someone to raise your hand and tell me one thing you see in that picture. Not the title of the picture. What do you see, Jean?
Blood on the tooth.
You see what?
Blood.
Blood on the, okay. Blood on the tooth. All right. Somebody else, what do you see? Scott?
I see
one thing. You see a,
some sort of lion head.
You see a lion's head, all right. Someone else, what do you see, Jerry?
A small black cat.
Jerry sees a small black cat, all right. Anybody else see anything? Kay?
I see a whale.
A whale? You see a what?
I'm mowed.
Oh. Oh. Interesting. Interesting. Okay. Nancy. Nancy sees a mouse. How many people see the mouse?
Mouse or cat?
I see both. We have a cat. Look right there. And we have a bloody tooth right there. And somewhere up there, there's a commode. I got to work that in somehow. Let's see. If you don't see the dog, you're going down the commode. Well, this kind of picture has a particular name. Can anyone tell me what kind of picture this is, what the name is?
Figural ground.
Its official title is Figural Ground Perception Picture. All right? Can anyone tell me why it's called a Figural Ground Perception Picture? Because when you look at something, you see something as the background, and you see something as the foreground. The thing that is in the foreground you see as the figure, and everything else you see as a background. Right? When you are looking at me, everything up there you don't pay any attention to, I hope. And I am the figure, and that is the background. And so we're going to talk this morning about perception. About what do people see? And we're going to talk about that because the passage in the Gospel of Luke where we are, that's what Jesus is talking about. Now, I'm going to try to teach this lesson in four or five different ways. I'm going to mix my metaphors and my analogies, and it's going to be ridiculously confusing, but that's how it's going to come out, I think. All right? So, of those three figures on the screen up there, how many people would like, let's start this way. When I say dog, what word comes to your mind? When you, one word, I say dog and you say what?
Cat.
Cat. That's not what I'm looking for, but that's it. How would you describe a dog, or what characteristics would you assign to a dog?
Friend.
depending.
Yeah. A lot of that depends upon the breed that you have experience with or don't have experience with. It also has to do with the personal experiences, whether you've been bitten or chased as a kid. But as a general rule, like when Pam and I had, we had black Labradors growing up. And so when we think dog, we think unconditional love, kindness, just sweetheart, wants to be with us. When you, about cat, when I say cat, how would you characterize cat or felines? Aloof.
Independent.
Could care less about you, for the most part. Right? Right? Cats are very independent, very much on their own. You know, dogs want to live in your world, cats allow you to live in theirs. All right, when you see a mouse, when you think of mouse, what comes to mind? Cat. Mouse trap. How would you characterize a mouse?
Ruben.
Sneaky? They don't want to be seen. They want to, you know, just go about their business and not encounter anybody else. All right, now here's the question, okay? How many people would love it if they were described as a dog? How many people would like to be described or perceived as a cat? How many people would like to be perceived as a mouse? I never get any takers. A mouse. Jesus is actually talking about dogs and cats and mice in the passage of Scripture that we're going to talk about. He's also talking about figural ground. He's also talking about perception. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Figural ground. The key question in the figural ground perception picture is, what do you see as the background and what do you see as the foreground? Right? Or to put it in the way that I want you to remember, what part of your life is black and what part of your life is white? Is the secular, the carnal side of you what everybody sees? Is that the foreground? Or is the sacred, the spiritual, the Christian side of your life, is that what everybody sees? What's the black and what's the white? We're going to read a passage from the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 6, verses 39 through 48, I believe, or 46, I can't remember. Hear now the word of the Lord. And he also spake a parable to them. A blind man cannot guide a blind man, can he? Will they not both fall into a pit? A pupil is not above his teacher, but everybody, after he has been fully trained, will be like his teacher. Why do you look at the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, "Brother, let me take the speck out of your eye," while you yourself do not see the log that is in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, and then you will be see clearly to take out the speck that is in your brother's eye. For there is no good tree which produces bad fruit, nor on the other hand, a bad tree which produces good fruit. For each tree is known by its own fruit. For men do not gather figs from thorns, nor do they pick grapes from a briar bush. The good man, out of the good treasure of his heart, brings forth what is good, and the evil man, out of the evil treasure, brings forth what is evil. For his mouth speaks from that which fills the heart. The word of God for the people of God. Amen. How many times in the course of your life have you heard the expression, the blind leading the blind? Anybody ever heard that before? Where, you know where that comes from? That's the description. It was an unfortunate truth in the first century that there were a lot of people who lost their sight. They had very poor hygiene. They had very poor medical care. There was a lot of wars and fighting and nastiness going on. And there were a lot of people walking around without sight. Now, preachers don't talk about Jesus' sense of humor very often. But this is a piece of evidence about Jesus' sense of humor. And I don't want you to think badly about him or to think that he was insensitive, but he's actually using an image that almost everybody in the first century would have been familiar with. The idea of someone having to lead a blind person. And he says, can you think of anything more ridiculous than a blind person leading a blind person? And I can just imagine his congregation laughing at that and poking each other. And it is possible that they might have even seen such a thing happen. You know? Come on, let's go. Nothing good will happen if a blind person leads a blind person. Now, what does that mean exactly? All right? For those of you who do not know it, I have to consult the car manual to decide how to open the gas cap before I can get gas. That is the level of auto mechanic that I am. So if I were to volunteer at the local community college to teach auto mechanics how to become an auto mechanic, it would be a classic definition of a blind leading the blind. Because I know absolutely nothing about those. What Jesus is talking about, he's talking to a specific group of people in his audience. He's talking to the group of people called the Pharisees. The Pharisees are a group of people that we call the religious police. And that's because roughly 176 years before Jesus was born, this group of men who were very religious and very faithful thought that the Jewish religion was going down the kibbutz. I knew I'd get it in. And so they wanted to do something about it. They wanted to protect Judaism. And so they said, by golly, we will become the police. We will enforce Judaism. We will make sure that society doesn't forget what it means to be a Jew. And now it's been like 8 generations later. And they are now walking around telling people what they should do and what they shouldn't do. This is a quote from Josephus, who was a first century Jewish historian who saw Jesus and watched what was going on. And this is a quote from him, a secular writer. Quote, the Pharisees are a body of Jews who profess to be more religious than the rest and to explain the laws more precisely. In point of fact, Pharisees made life difficult for everybody, including themselves. And Jesus says to them, he says, you know, the blind wouldn't attempt to lead the blind. And he's talking to them. And he's talking to them because they profess to be the ones that are most knowledgeable about the Messiah. And they are correcting Jesus. Jesus says, I don't need to be told what the Messiah is going to do or be. Now, it's quite obvious that Jesus realizes that everybody doesn't get the story, doesn't get the point of the story, so he teaches the same lesson a second time, using a different analogy. And in this analogy, he says, a pupil is not above his teacher, but everyone, after he's been fully trained, will be like his teacher. Again, he speaks to the Pharisees, who are the teachers of the law. And they're going to go around and tell everybody and teach everybody what needs to be done. And Jesus says, you don't know everything. In point of fact, you know so little, you're actually a student, not a teacher. I am the teacher. And because he doesn't think they get it, he teaches the same lesson a third way. And he uses a rhetorical device, which was very common in that day, called hyperbola. Hyperbola. Anyone want to give me a definition of a hyperbola?
Exaggerated.
Exaggerated. That's right. You're making the point by going way out there. The literal translation from the Greek is, if I can find it quickly, overshooting the mark. Deliberately overshooting the mark. Is Jesus literally saying somebody's got a log in their eye and they shouldn't be trying to take the speck out of somebody else's eye? That's hyperbole. He's not lying. He's using a rhetorical device common of his day to make a point. And what's the point that he's trying to make? Pharisees have logs in their eyes. Because they don't understand who Jesus is. They don't understand what the point of the whole thing is. That wasn't enough. He teaches it yet a fourth way. Talks about fruit-bearing plants. Why do we call an apple tree? Because it bears apples. Have you ever seen a tree that bears apples and pears and oranges? Why do we call an orange tree an orange tree? We call the tree what it is because of what we get from the tree. At the end of the parsonage driveway is a great big giant tree with big round green things on it right now. Do you want to refer it to? It's a walnut tree. And we know that because every fall these big round green things come down and the squirrels bring them down. And Jesus' point is this. The most useless piece of shrubbery in the first century was a thing called bantos. B-A-N-T-O-S. Bantos was the Greek word for any bush that produced thorns. There's no use. There is no value whatsoever. Nothing that can be done with a bush with thorns. So Jesus says, you wouldn't go out and expect to pick grapes from a bantos, would you? For there is no good tree which produces bad fruit, nor on the other hand, a bad tree which produces good fruit. For each tree is known by its own fruit. A fig tree is a fig tree because it produces figs. What is his point? We are called Christians because we bear the fruit of Jesus Christ. And what is the fruit of Jesus Christ? Which you will hear me repeat 10,000 times before I die or you fire me. All right? There's four basic traits that mark every Christian's life. And if you want to know whether you belong to Jesus Christ or not, are these four characteristics in your life. Number one, selfless love. I told the kids yesterday as I married them. You know what? Marriage is all about selfless love. You don't enter a marriage to see what you can get from the other person. You're supposed to enter the marriage to see what you can give. Selfless love, unconditional kindness, unconditional forgiveness, unconditional generosity, the fruit of Christianity. They will know us by our love. Let me ask the question this way, okay? Let me try to make the point this way. Let's say that a stranger walked into the building after service is over, and this stranger says, I'd like to meet with the pastor. And you say, look for the guy who, what would you say? How would you describe me to a stranger? Janie would just take the stranger and I appreciate that. I'm trying to get you to say, and it won't hurt my feelings, trust me, okay? What is the first thing that you notice about me that would be the first thing you'd say to a stranger? He's got white hair, all right? And then the second thing you would say? He's got a big white bushy mustache. And then what would you say? It's about, he's short, he's old, and he's overweight. Would you not? Huh? Right? Because one of the predominant characteristics that you see when you look at me, right? White hair, white mustache, short, overweight. Once upon a time, I was in a community theater production where I needed to be several years younger, and they dyed my hair brown, my mustache brown. I swear to you that, well, I had worked with these particular cast of people for 13 weeks. I walked in for dress rehearsal night. The director turns and says to me, this is a closed rehearsal, strangers are not allowed here. Honest truth. And I smiled, and he looked at me kind of funny, and then I said something, and he said, oh my, it's Dave! Nobody knew me. Nobody knew me. Why? Because you identify me as white hair, white mustache. All right? Well, I almost did this, because I thought this would be a wonderful exercise. I wanted to write everybody's name down on a piece of paper. And I wanted to draw a line beside of it, and I wanted to make 100 copies, and I wanted to pass them out. I almost did this. And I would have told you, go home, and when you see Phil's name, just put one word beside of Phil Morgan. The one thing that comes to mind when you see Phil Morgan or Charlie Goblin or, right? And then I thought about compiling them all and handing the sheet to Phil and say, here's what 100 people who go to church, here's the 100 things they said. Would that not be revealing to you? Would that not be an eye-opener to you? Would that not identify for you whether you're black or white? Would that not make it painfully obvious to you what is the figure and what is the ground of your life? I don't want people to describe me by my external appearance. I want people to describe me by my internal appearance. I want people to say, go look for the guy who's passionate, who's praying and preaching and shouting the name of Jesus Christ. Go find that guy. Don't go find the old guy with the bushy white mustache. Find the guy full of fire for Jesus Christ. That's what I want people to say about me. What's the figure? I know. The point I'm trying to make is we become known by certain things. There are certain identifiers, and I want this church family to be identified by the marks of Christ. I often do this at funerals when I have trouble getting people to share a eulogy or a comment. I say, well, let's just say one word. Okay, give me one word that would describe the deceased. And pretty soon I get everybody started talking, and then the stories start to flow. What do you think the number one word that we would hear about you? You know? What would be the one thing that would dominate that everybody would say about you? What's the figure? And what is the back? I think it's a very healthy exercise for us to sit down and to think about what is the black in my life and what is the white. What do people see as the background in my life? Is church the background and my job the foreground, or my family, or my Jesus talked to these Pharisees in Matthew as well. And he said to them in Matthew, woe to you scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs. On the outside you appear beautiful, but inside you're full of dead men's bones and uncleanliness. When people see the outside, they see a nice, happy, beautiful person, while the inside's full of death and decaying spirit. All right, let me bring this bucket to a close. I was going to bring two buckets today. I don't know if I've ever used this analogy or not, but I was going to bring two buckets and two sponges, but I didn't get it done. And one bucket was going to be full of dirty water, and one bucket was going to be full of clean water, and I was going to pull up the two sponges, and I was going to ask you to tell me which sponge had the dirty water and which sponge has the clean water. And if I did it right and didn't oversaturate the sponge, when I pulled them up, they would both look exactly the same. How could you tell which sponge has the dirty water and which sponge has the clean water? Anybody?
Squeeze it.
Would you like to know what's in your heart? Would you like to know who you really are? Would you like to know what characteristics really in your heart? Wait till life squeezes you. Amen? Then you'll find out what's inside. We need to understand that faith is the figure and secular is the background. Young family went to church, and the father professed to be a Christian, the mother professed to be a Christian. They had three little children. The boy was 7 years old, and he watched as his father listened to the pastor preach, and he listened as his father leaned over to his mother and complained about some of the things the pastor was saying. As they got ready to leave the church, the little boy watched and heard His father complained about something having been changed in the lobby of the church. Later, they got in the car, they went out to dinner, and they had lunch. And as they went to get out of the car, the father banged his knee on the car door and expressed his feelings in four-letter words, and the little boy listened. As they were driving to the restaurant, another driver cut them off, and the father gave the other driver the finger and told him a few things. And then the father prayed over the meal and asked God's blessing over the meal. And after they were done and they were eating, the little boy said, "Daddy, can I ask you a question?" And his dad said, "Sure." "Daddy, does God hear everything that we say?" And the father said, "Yes, absolutely." "Did God hear you when you were criticizing what the pastor said?"
"Yes."
"Did God hear you when you cursed out the other driver?" The father's beginning to be a little uncomfortable. He said, "Yes." "Did God hear you when you banged your knee against the door?" "Yes." "Did God hear you when you asked a blessing for the meal?" "Yes." "Daddy, which time did God believe you?" Black or white? Figure or round? Who are you? What do people really see? Let's bow our heads. Father, I pray for your spirit to speak, to penetrate, to help people understand that there's no point in playing games. There's no value in pretending to go through the motions and act like somebody who belongs to you. There's nothing to be gained from that. I pray, Father, that every person in this room will take an honest look at their souls, at their belief system, at who they really are. That I, too, will look hard at who I am, what I do, and the image I project, and the witness that I provide. Help us all to be the real deal. Help us to see what other people see. I ask these things in the name of Jesus.